Talking about family improvement. We're talking about marriages now and how to have a strong marriage. Next week will be Palm Sunday and then Easter, and then we'll have Faith Promise, and then we'll do a sermon on how to be single and to be pure. And so it'll be for, if you know single people around you, invite them on that day to be a part. This Jerome needs some help with this. This isn't turning now. There we go. We talked about the foundation of marriage, leave and cleave, the foundation of marriage. And then we talked about the foe of marriage, which is divorce. And then we talked last week about the fruit of marriage. The mirror of God is the Trinity. It's me and my spouse and God, this triangle, this Trinity. The world can see Jesus through a godly marriage. And as I said, April 30th, we'll be talking about being single as a gift. And you can see the manger there. Jesus was single. How do you decide who to marry? How do you decide who to marry? And I thought it was interesting. There were some little kids that were asked, how do you decide who to marry? And there was a little boy, Alan, age 10, and he said, you got to find somebody who likes the same stuff. Like if you like sports, she should like it that you like sports, and she should keep the chips and dip coming. Derek, age 8, was asked, how can a stranger tell if two people are married? He said, you might have to guess based on whether they seem to be yelling at the same kids. Another one here, Anita, age 9, she was asked, is it better to be single or married? She said, it's better for girls to be single, but not for boys. Boys need someone to clean up after them. And then Ricky, age 10, this is my favorite. He was asked, how would you make a marriage work? He said, tell your wife that she looks pretty, even if she looks like a truck. Oh, from the mouths of babes. The fight for marriage that we're talking about today. We had the foundation, we had the foe, the fruit of marriage. Today is the fight for marriage. 1 Corinthians 13, 4 through 8. The fight for marriage, not the fight in your marriage, not the fight against marriage, but we're talking today about the fight for your marriage. And it is a fight. It's a battle. Satan is always trying to work to destroy the church. And the way he does that is he works in families in the church. Whether you're single or married, he is trying to work in your life to leverage darkness against the light. And you must stand up and you must fight against him. Fight against Satan. We're going to see how do we fight? How do we fight for our marriage? 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 4 through 8. This word that we keep using in this verse is love, and it's the Greek word agape. It's God's love for us, not based on our merit, but based on his unconditional idea that he wants to love us. God's love for us. 1 Corinthians 13, 4 through 8. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It is not rude. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. A great test that you can do there, I do it in premarital counseling, is to put your name in there. Wherever it says love, put your name there. Don't point your finger at your spouse. Point at yourself. Noel is patient. Noel is kind. And go through that. It's very humbling to do that. Don't point at your spouse. Look in the mirror and say, God, am I the person you want me to be? So the fight for marriage. Fight for your marriage like it's under attack from the powers of hell. Because it is. If Satan could undermine marriage, he'd go a long way in destroying the church, wouldn't he? God has given the gift of marriage to us. And if we fulfill our duties to God and to our spouse, it's a beautiful thing. And it's a tribute to his grace in our life. It's a tribute to what he can do in other people's lives if they'll just look and watch. Let your marriage be something that people can look at and say, wow, I want my marriage to be like that. It's the love chapter. It's interesting. We call it the love chapter. The love chapter. This is written to the Corinthians. They were a people that were saved, but they were saved out of a lot of stuff like we are. They were saved out of all kinds of sin, deep, dark sin. And now they all gather together, and there's some pride coming up in the heart of these Corinthians, and they're wanting to say, I'm better than that person. I have more gifts. I have more spiritual gifts than the other person. And so 1 Corinthians 12 is all about spiritual gifts, and 1 Corinthians 14 is all about spiritual gifts. It's interesting, sandwiched between those two chapters is 1 Corinthians 13, all about God's love for us. It's beautiful for marriages, it's beautiful for church boards, it's beautiful for churches, it's beautiful for Sunday school classes, that we would live by the love of God in our heart. It's not you just trying to tolerate people around you, it's saying, God, fill me with your love so that I can love them with your love. It's a totally different game. It's not you just trying to muster up what you can. It's you allowing God's love to love through you. Totally different. Totally different. Is it real or is it fake? I don't want plastic love. Can't you tell when your spouse is just doing something because you told them to do that? I mean, there have been times in my life, my wife says, you need to tell me that you love me. I love you. No, say it like you mean it. I love you. No, from your heart, I love you, whatever it is. You know, is it real or is it fake? Is it real or is it fake? I mean, can you imagine, have you seen those, you go to the store and they're trying to sell a grill to you, and they've got plastic steak on there. It looks so real. The fake stuff they put on, it looks so, you're like, is that a piece of meat laying there? And you go over, no, you touch it, it's hard, it's plastic. You could tell the difference whenever the pressure comes, though, if you have real love or fake love, if you're married. You put a plastic steak on a grill and you turn it on, you turn the heat up. First of all, it begins to melt, and then you start smelling this awful odor, and it just kind of drips through the grill down into the bottom, and you have nothing left. But if you have a real steak, put that on the grill, thick, juicy T-bone. I'm getting kind of hungry. You're thinking about that. And you put that on there and you turn that heat up and you season it, and that real steak begins to cook and it puts off a beautiful aroma. The heat on that real steak makes it a beautiful aroma. And I think if we have real love in our hearts, when the heat is turned up, it'll be a beautiful aroma that'll come out in our homes. But if it's fake love, it's going to be putrid. There are four types of love in the Greek. Three of them are mentioned in the New Testament. Eros, which is sexual love. It comes naturally. Storge, this is not mentioned in the Bible, but this is a love that the Greeks used. It's family love. It comes naturally. Philos, we get the word Philadelphia, city of brotherly love. It's a friend love. It comes naturally. And the love we're talking about this morning is agape love. It's godly love, and it does not come naturally. It comes supernaturally. You must ask God to help you, to assist you with your love relationships, that God's love is in you. It's the unconditional love of God for all people. Love as revealed in Jesus, which is selfless and a model for everyone. Love is patient. Love is kind. That's quite a list. Do you love everybody? Do you love your spouse? Do you love your kids? Do you love your aunts, your uncles, your grandparents? Do you really love them? Do you love people in this church? When you look around, you see somebody coming down the hall and you're like, man, they had a grievance against me a while ago. Do you turn and try to act like you're going out a different door? Or do you really just go up and say, I just love you? It's not your love being amped up. It's the love of God flowing freely through you. If you don't have that, it's here for you today. The person of Jesus Christ is here today to give you His love. To love all people, bad neighbors, stinky neighbors, ugly neighbors. Doesn't matter. God gives you love to love everybody. It's a cool thing when He does that. In this fight for our marriage, I want to focus on those first two words. Love is patient, love is kind. Love is patient. Patient. Patient means to be of long spirit, not to lose heart, to persevere patiently and bravely in enduring misfortunes and troubles, to be patient in bearing the offenses and injuries of others, to be mild and slow in avenging, to be long-suffering, slow to anger, slow to punish. Inside that egg, you can see all the little marks there, the cat marks. How many pecks did it take to get out of that egg? It took a lot. There's a lot of cat marks there. And I think for us, it's long, Lord, fill me with your patience, to have a long fuse. Lord, help me. Lord, help me. Luke 18:7, Jesus uses this same word, long-suffering. He said, "And shall not God avenge his own elect, which cry day and night to him, though he bear long with them?" Paul uses the same word in 1 Thessalonians. Admonish the idle, encourage the faint-hearted, help the weak, be patient with them all. All the things that you saw in that special someone before you got married that were awesome, once you get married, those things become more awesome. Conversely, the things that you saw in your spouse before you got married that kind of bugged you also grow after you're married because you're around them all the time. You see them. But love is patient. Love chooses to love in spite of all the idiosyncrasies that your spouse has. Now, you can raise your hand if your spouse has more idiosyncrasies than you. Oh, you guys are smart. Nobody voted. That was smart. If you have more idiosyncrasies than your spouse, raise your hand. Okay, good. Some of you are honest. Yeah. Some of you were bumped and then you raised your hand. That's good. James, half-brother of Jesus, said this. Use the same word. You also be patient. Establish your hearts, for the coming of the Lord is at hand. Those are just different ways that it's used throughout the Bible. Now this word kind, it means to show oneself mild, to be kind, use kindness, act benevolently, gently. It comes from the word, the etymology is the word kinfolk, to be kind. It can be a small act, a mild act, a kind word of encouragement spoken over someone or helping someone in need with physical labor, financial assistance, a cup of coffee. God is love and he acts mildly to us too. Kindness is to act, but mildly. Kind doesn't sit back in the back and watch things happen and let it go on. Kind gets up and helps. Talking with a couple yesterday, they were talking about their daughter at school. And something was going on where a boy was saying something very mean to somebody else, and this person's daughter got right in between and stopped that act from going on any further. That is kindness. Kindness is not passive. Kindness works. And love is kind. The last hurtful thing that you said to your spouse, don't say it out loud, just think on that. What's the last hurtful thing you said to your spouse? Okay, you can't think of anything. Just think the last time your spouse cried. That's probably something you hurt them with. You say, well, I didn't say anything unkind. Your wife cried, you said something unkind. Doesn't matter what you think, you hurt your wife. So kindness, love is kind. Kindness goes to the spouse and says, I'm sorry, would you forgive me? Kind doesn't just sit there and go, well, you know, she was wrong. Kindness goes and acts. Kindness moves. Kindness is active. The three most common marriage conflicts, you can read about these. It's in-laws is number one. Number two is intimacy issues. And number three is finances. And if you don't have good communication, those three will unravel like crazy. You might pick out which one's the weakest in your marriage. Is it in-laws? Be careful, because in-laws can become outlaws if you're not careful. Intimacy issues, sexuality issues, those can be big issues within marriage. And then finances, the lack thereof or too many. What do you do with them? Are you single? I tell my kids this. Remember, every date is a potential mate. Every person you go out with could eventually become your spouse. Think about the person you're married to now. You had to go out on a date with them at least, right? Now, that first date, you didn't think, they're going to be my spouse, or you may have, but probably you didn't. I remember when my mom told me this when I was in like the eighth grade. She said, Noel, remember, every person you go out with could eventually become your spouse. And I remember going to school that day and just walking down the halls and looking at all these girls, kind of thinking, she's got big ears. And I know that my dad told me that two things on your body grow the rest of your life, your ears and your nose. Her ears were big then. What would it be like when she's 80? I thought those things. I'm not joking. I thought those things. Windstorm, hold on to her, you know. Dumbo, you know, you got to be careful. I thought that. I took that to heart. This one girl, I walked by her, and I thought she was so good looking, and I began to talk to her. I thought, oh, she's got some qualities. I'm eighth grade. Come on. Eighth grade. And I'm talking to her, and I tell her a joke, and she had the most hideous laugh. It was kind of this high-pitched, and I was like, every date is a potential mate. I thought, well, I like to tell jokes. And what if I'm with her and, what in the world? What was that? Or I'm with her in public and somebody's going to tell me a joke. I go, no, hold on. Hold her ears. I want her to laugh. I know that's so shallow, but that's the way it starts. That, you know, you think about that those things about the other person, they're going to be with him forever. Every date is a potential mate. So if you're with a loser when you're dating, a loser when you're married. So the best time to get a divorce is before you get married. Get out of those relationships. Women, don't hang out with those guys that are telling you all the stuff you want to hear and then they're out running around. Get rid of them now. Jettison them from your life. Husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. Ephesians 5:25. Husbands, love your wives how? Just as Christ loved the church. How much did Christ love the church? Did he love her this much? He loved her this much. And he died on a cross for the church. You've got to die to yourself to love your spouse the way that Christ loves the church. Love your spouse. Love your wife. Husbands, love your wives well. This is interesting. You are teaching your sons how they should treat women, and you're teaching your daughters what they should expect from men. Isn't that interesting? Your daughter, hey, listen, man, your daughter is probably going to marry somebody kind of like you. So be careful. Show your daughters how to treat a woman. Greater love has no one than this, that he lay down his life for his friends. That's a great verse Jesus gives, John 15:13. Greater love. This is the greatest kind of love. The highest love, agape love. The greatest love is laying down your life for somebody else. Man, are you doing that for your wife? I remember whenever our kids were little, I think we just had Chloe, the third of our four, and Sheree was nursing our babies, and so I didn't have to wake up to nurse them, but they would have to go to the bathroom, seemed like, after that. And so we kind of took turns. It's like their systems, their digestive systems would not work properly. I thought they should eat and go to the bathroom really quickly while Sheree was still up. But they would eat and then go to sleep and then go to the bathroom, and so then I would get the elbow in my back. What? Hey, go take care of the little one. I remember Chloe, we'd put her across. We had a split bedroom plan in this house in Florida, and we were on one side and our kids were on the other. Ashton and Elijah are asleep, and Chloe's in her own crib, and Sheree had just fed her, put her to bed, and a few minutes later, she hears this crying, and I feel the elbow in the back. And I remember getting up. And I was getting up mad. I was angry. I was in a bad mood. And I, who had all these kids anyway, you know, I'm kind of going across the house. And as I was walking across a long living room area over, I just said, God, would you help me? I mean, I was just mad. I was so mad. I was like, God, would you help me? And I don't know what happened, folks, but God heard my prayer. And all of a sudden, my whole attitude changed from the walk from our bedroom across our living room over to where the bedrooms were. And as I walked across and I'd said, God, would you help me? He did. And my attitude changed and I thought, you know what? I'm doing this for Jesus. My wife represents Jesus. My daughter represents Jesus, right? The people around us represent Jesus. We serve them as though we were serving Jesus. And as I walked across, I remember changing her diaper, and she was awake, and she was cooing. She was just wide awake. She's all happy. And I remember just kind of talking to her, and it just changed the whole deal. It's such a small area, I know. It's just a small thing, right? It's a small thing. But I think God wants to give us his agape love for all people. I think about the love and the care that Pastor Joe Lee gives to his spouse. Lord, help me. I don't know if you have to say that. Every day. And the Lord does. He gives us agape love to love. This is not a romantic love. This is not a feel-good love. This is God's love in us. fighting for your marriage, praying together and serving together. I think it's important. The best way to stop fighting is start working together. Quit focusing on the fight that you have in your marriage and focus on something positive you can do together, like ministry. What are your spiritual gifts? What are your spouse's spiritual gifts? Pray together and serve together. Love is a verb. Love is a verb. It doesn't just sit there. Love is in action. I remember asking the Wednesday night class a question. I said, why don't we share our faith? Why don't we share our faith with others? And one person said, well, you know, we don't have enough knowledge. We need more skill. Another one said, well, I don't have time. I'm busy. Another one said, well, I just get scared and I get tongue-tied. I don't know what to say. And then another one said this, another one said that. And finally, somebody said, you know, the reason I don't share my faith is because I don't care about lost people. That was a little too honest for me in church. Can we be that honest in church, Scott Springer? That's who said that. And he said, the reason I don't share my faith is because I don't care about lost people. He said, if I cared about them, I'd do something about it. Now, he does. He does share his faith, but he was being really honest. He said, the reason we don't share our faith is we don't care about lost people. That's just really honest, isn't it? Are you sharing your faith? Is your marriage sharing your faith by your love for one another? Do you really care about your spouse? God joined you together, now serve together. There you stand at the altar, tuxedo and wedding gown. God joined you together, now serve together. What do you do? Spouse, what do you do, spouse? What is your gifting? Serve together. It's amazing how that'll help you to fight for your marriage. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good, Paul said in Romans 12. Do not be overcome by evil. Don't let your marriage be overcome by evil, but overcome evil by doing good in your marriage. Husbands, wives, work together. Serve together. It's amazing what will happen in your life as you get your eyes off of your problem and start working toward good in other people's lives. The happiest, most fulfilled lives are those who give themselves to others in service. You know that. This is a whole sermon in one slide. SHAPE, it's an acronym for knowing your spiritual gift. Your spiritual gift is S. H is your heart's passion. A is abilities. What abilities do you have? P is personality styles. And E is experiences. And then I put four E's down there. You've got to employ your spiritual gift, enjoy your spiritual gift, encourage others with your spiritual gift, and enable others to become all that they can be with your spiritual gift. I don't know. I just wonder if, woman, what's your spiritual gift? Man, what's your spiritual gift? Did God join you together? Yes. He's joined you together. Now use your gifts together. Some say, well, we're so different. How could we ever work together? Well, pray about it. Pray with your spouse and say, God, how can you use our spiritual gifts in our marriage to serve others? You don't have to be a lone ranger, man. Woman, you don't have to be a lone ranger. Work together. Well, we're so different. I'm an extrovert. She's an introvert, or vice versa. Well, figure it out. Look around you. How do people in this church do it? How do they work together in their marriage? I like to pray. My husband likes to do this. Well, how about pray for the people that you're going and visiting? You know, see, just put your gifts together. Work together. I love this glove, agape love. It's controlled by the Spirit. If you had a glove and you threw it down and you said, glove, move around, it's not going to do it. You're using your mind to try to make that glove move. It's not going to do it. But when you put your hand in that glove, your mind now makes all the fingers work together inside that same glove. And I think the Spirit does that in our marriages. If you're filled with the Spirit and your spouse is filled with the Spirit, you're not going to be like this all the time. That's not the Holy Spirit. That's another kind of spirit in your marriage. The Holy Spirit is not going to make you bust heads with your spouse all day, every day. You've got to be filled with the Spirit, controlled by the Spirit. Sanctified marriage. We use that word. Sanctified just means to make holy, to set apart. It means to cut away. We cut away the flesh to make holy. Is your marriage sanctified? Is your marriage entirely sanctified for God's purposes and uses? Think about that. Pray that God would sanctify your marriages. Set them apart. Make them holy. A simple question to ask your spouse. That's my beautiful wife when she was teaching. Leaning over, asking a question of a kid. They caught her and they took a picture. But a simple question to ask your spouse. How can I pray for you? It's amazing. You can find out a lot about somebody when you just ask that simple question. Cherie, how can I pray for you? And you might get this, oh, where do I start? We'll pick one area. Give me one area. And she may say, patience. And I know to walk out of the room at that point. No, I'm kidding. But I pray with her. Maybe it's out loud right there, or maybe it's I go aside and I pray. Maybe it's under my breath. It's just quietly. But pray with your spouse. Ask your spouse, how can I pray for you? It's a great question. How to fight for your marriage. These are five things you can do. How to fight for your marriage. Number one, pray with your spouse. Number two, listen to podcasts on marriage. There's lots of good podcasts out there. Read books on marriage. Number four, each find an older Christian who will encourage and inspire you to love your spouse. And number five, maybe go on one marriage retreat in the year. Could you do that? We've got Dennis Rainey right over here in Little Rock who does marriage seminars all the time. Pastor Bob, could I have you stand and come up and Pastor Luke, you want to help me? We've got some cards here. I want every married couple to get one of these cards, or two, I guess, one for the man, one for the woman. And maybe some other men, anybody, come on up here. Scott, Jason, come on over. Would you guys help pass these out to married couples? Just hold up your hand. If your spouse isn't here, go ahead and take one and pass these out. What's on the card is just what's on the screen, and I want to give that to you to put in your Bible, to put in your hand, give you a tool that you can say, I want my marriage to be better, and maybe I'll work on two of these out of the five. Have some goals for your marriage. Pray with your spouse. That's number one. If there's one thing that you could do, it'd be to pray with your spouse. To pray with your spouse. Pray with your spouse. And the best thing you could do is when you're praying is just coming to Jesus. We're going to close in just a moment. There was a time I was fighting with my wife, and she had said something to hurt me. I had said something to hurt her, but she was the one that was mainly in the wrong. I've told some of you this before, she was 98% wrong. I was 2% wrong. So I was out in the living room, and our kids were gone somewhere, and she's in the bathroom just boo-hooing in our master bedroom bath. She's just boo-hooing. I'd hurt her feelings bad, and she'd hurt mine. And so I was out there just like getting my defense together, what I was going to say to her. I was walking back and forth in the living room, and I'm going to tell her this, and I'm going to tell her this, and I had three good points I was going to communicate to her. And it's like the Lord tapped me on the shoulder and said, you're 100% responsible for your 2%. The Lord didn't even try to convince me that I had more wrong than 2%. He just said, you're 100% responsible for your 2%. That's not what you want to hear when you're getting ready to go make your case. My whole attitude changed. The Lord softened my heart, and I went in, and I could hear her in the bathroom. I'd hurt her feelings. She's bawling like a baby. My fault. And so I knock on the door. Cherie, she's like, what? I said, open the door. No! I said, Cherie, I need to apologize to you. What? She opened the door, and man, I train wrecked her. Her face just looked like somebody tracked down black stuff all down here. And I said, Cherie, I'm sorry. And she just kind of fell into my arms, and she started crying a different cry. She's now going, oh, that's all I wanted you to say. Sometimes we're slow, aren't we, men? And it was amazing. That one thing, me saying, Cherie, I'm sorry, made all the difference. You know what happened there? Jesus came to me. And he filled me with his agape love. I didn't have that in myself. All I had was wanting to win an argument. But my Jesus filled me with his agape love, 1 Corinthians 13 love, and then I was able to love with his love, and it made the whole difference. Men, women, let God's agape love fill you.